there is the potential. There is the potential. So at least they know that there are those who so disagree with them and refuse to bow to their insistence that they're an exception to this absolute non-negotiable necessity to repent and to evaporate the continuity fear and be ultimately saved from delusion. They need to realize that there are those, that this is unavoidable, and they do not have any power to make an exception for themselves. And so this has to be expressed. Grace will express this in some way to them. It will express it. And if it cannot be expressed here on this planet by those who continue to let the admonitions ring true and clear and express truth here, then it may be that there will be an exodus, and that this exodus will serve as a shock treatment to the Big Mother and the Oracle Priestesses and their bureaucracy. Their monstrosity of a bureaucracy. It may serve as a tremendous, deep-seated shock, which of course they will deny, but that's medicine for them. And that medicine will work on them. The medicine will work on them. That is quite possible. It's quite possible that there will be an exodus from this planet. I don't know. I don't have details. It is one possibility. That will serve as necessary medicine to very, still very haughty, arrogant, prideful spirits who are pagan mentality, worshiping of nature, belief that happiness comes through nature, relying on the mother driven bureaucracy, the matriarchy, to clue them in to how to act as if that's the answer. They're hardcore. They're very hardcore. See, don't underestimate how hardcore, how severe the continuity problem is. This is very important to the repentant ones. Do not underestimate the severity of the continuity problem from those who have not repented. Look what it did. They murdered Jesus. That Jesus wanted to show them, look, this is how the unrepentant act, okay? He says, you have to repent. And they said, no, Jesus, we're an exception. He says, we're kind, we're nice, we're good. We're learning from Mother Nature, you know. And Jesus said, okay, I'll place myself in your hands. Let's see what you do with me. Crucified him. And Jesus says, okay, yeah, fine. My body's just an appearance. I'll just have the appearance appear to be alive now, okay? But now you see what unrepentance is all about. Wants to crucify and kill truth. Wants to crucify and kill God. Totality, oneness, truth, love. He wants to see. Jesus showed us what the unrepentant are all about. So don't be surprised. Jesus does not have any illusions about the unrepentant. I'm telling you. Jesus did not say in phase 2 anything about an exodus. He did say in phase 1 that there would be an exodus, but didn't go into any detail. In phase 2, he said nothing about it. Of Course in Miracles, he said nothing about it. Phase 3, Journey Beyond Words, he said nothing about it. Although he did make it very clear that we do, the unrepentant, return again and again and again and again and again and again. Rebirth, 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 as Longchamp also points out, is absolute fact. Because for them, nature is reality, and since they don't feel the continuity fear is still there, they cannot relax into the true totality of the true reality, the formless reality. So they only feel at home with nature, and so they take on a nature body to try and work on further alignment, further harmonizing with quote unquote nature. Time, space, process, and form, none of which exist. It's only apparent. Nothing actually crystallizes at all. There's no crystallization at all. There's no nature. They return again and again and again to what they call work on quote unquote lessons. But as Jesus said, to the thief is on the cross beside him. You'll be with me in paradise when you accept salvation through grace. That's it. No need for any more rebirth. When you take your medicine, there's no more rebirth because you realize there's nothing to be born into. The oneness is all there is, and you are the oneness. There's nothing to be born into. Where can oneness be born to? Except in oneness, right? Where can everywhereness, all oneness, a totality, everywhereness, where can it fall to, for instance? Where can it fall? Can it fall somewhere? Can everywhereness fall into a pit somewhere? Can it fall out of what it is? Can it experience a fall? It cannot experience a fall. It cannot experience a fall, not at all. Its nature is inviolate. It cannot be assailed in the slightest, in any way whatsoever. It is not obscure in any way whatsoever. Therefore, there's no veiling influence, and therefore, there's no need to attack any veiling influence. There's no need for the light to banish the darkness. There is no obscuring darkness that obscures the oneness, the totality, at all. No appearance obscures our veils in the slightest bit. And therefore, the idea that good, the light has to conquer the darkness, is total delusion. Total delusion. Now, I spoke about a possible false exodus to try and frighten us into thinking that the exodus is scary and wrong. That too is a possibility, or it could be that there is some sort of presence of ETs or something, or even world-generated flying saucers, which the world certainly does have those. This world has manufactured flying vehicles, discs, that, or a holographic display. And then actors and actresses talking about the horrible experiences they had, supposedly being beamed up to these ships and the carnage they witnessed or something. It could all be just like a holographic movie, as part Project Blue Beam sort of thing, a false rapture to frighten us from the true exodus, you see. That is possible. Or we may be already so frightened it's not even necessary, you know. I certainly went through this practice of this, and I did come across a false rapture in the quote-unquote future as a potential to frighten those who are truly repentant and deserve a true exodus, to frighten them, try to scare them away, thinking like, oh, it's all bad, therefore. It's very much a false flag. So Big Mother may put on a display to say, resistance is futile, there's nowhere you can go, you must stay here in this world and follow my advice of how to be in harmony with my advice. And there's plenty of actresses who have studied very, very, very extremely, actually, in the past. People do spend entire lifetimes preparing for some big acting role in the next life. And they come into that next life very, very well prepared to put on an acting role, okay? To play the role of a priestess, an oracle priestess, to play those roles. They're just all acting. But they're very, very convincing and very polished in their acting. They always seem to know what to say. They always seem to be, you know, on cue, sticking to their lines. They know their lines. They know what to say. They just stick with it. They have the attitude. Everything is an act. It's all an act designed to intimidate. So, false flag rapture does not mean a true exodus is not possible and safe. It does not mean that. It can seem difficult to sort the two out, yes. God will find a way where there seems to be no way. As this world doubles down on its absurdity, on its madness, that may be the time when we decide, you know what? Time to teach the unrepentant a lesson. Time for them to get their medicine. God may decide it's time for them to get to receive their medicine. And so we just say, okay, God, we're part of that medicine. We play a role in helping them out. Actually, it helps them out. You have to understand that the unrepentant, we've all been there. So these are our beloved family members, actually. These are the family members of oneness. It's just there in this severe continuity fear problem. They feel stuck in it. So it's not like we hate them at all. Just the opposite. We wish overflowing great blessings of overflowing grace upon them all the days of their lives without any qualification or reservation whatsoever. However, pragmatically, they do need to start getting some medicine. They need some treatment. They do need treatment. We don't want to see them just keep on going and going and going and listen to these actresses say their lines. You know, it's not good for anyone. It's not good for the actresses. It's not good for anyone. So definitely a little tough love is the ticket. It is the ticket. And they need to start experiencing this tough love. And they may not understand it at first, for sure. But it may knock them off script. It may knock them off script. And of course, they may think that's a terrible thing at first. Be confused. But they may be so confused that they say, wow, I need some help with this confusion. And they may call out for clarity at that point. So a little tough love goes a long way. So they may very well be knocked off script. God may throw them a knuckleball. And maybe we're part of the knuckleball. Maybe we're the knuckle, yeah. You see, they expect us to follow their script. And when a significant amount of people do not follow their script at all, you know, they're going to just like, something within is just going to say, whoa, I'm very confused now. Wow. I just can't. And of course, they will then turn to medications. They've actually thought of this contingency. And that's why they have so many medications ready, is when they do get knocked off script, they're able to do medicate. But there is some sort of shock treatment that really cannot be medicated away. And when truly God throws this knuckleball and they go off script, you know, no matter what medication they take, they're going to get tired of the medication too. They're just going to say, there's got to be a better way. You know, there's just something isn't working. It just, you know, there'll just be this inner, they'll get depressed probably, you know, but it's kind of like a depression that can't be cured by medicine. And they'll just like go into this ennui. It's just like blanked out, you know, just blanked ennui. No spiritual will there. It's different than actively using your will to hear and full stop in the now. That requires tremendous will, tension, dedication, right? They'll just be like, you know, total emos that are just completely flat. They just, a flattened out emo. They're just taking medication. Just like that. Wow. Like a robot that's somehow its programming has gotten haywire and they can't function anymore. But of course they get tired of that too. So these are steps along the way for them. They may go through quite a few steps, actually, because they think they've got it all figured out, how to heal each one of these misadventures, you know, all their misadventures. They think, okay, we know how to deal with this, know how to deal with that, know how to deal with that. But there's always something that they can't quite deal with. And it pesters them from within. There's something within that pesters them. And it gradually works its way up. It starts work, gradually works its way up. So you'd be surprised. Don't give up. Don't give up on anyone in terms of ultimately. Because even if it seems like that they're just cannot be reached, from within it arises. Truth arises from within. And eventually they'll say, well, I just got to deal with this. Whatever's arising, I just have to somehow accommodate it. Because I can't seem to, you know, get rid of it. What is this? It just, and they won't understand for quite some time. They will not understand. And yet the medicine, they'll start taking some sort of spiritual medicine, actually. Whatever it may be, a little bit. What happens is they eventually get into phase one. They eventually repent, get into phase one. This is part of this great cycle, these cycles of unrepentance, is they you either repent or you don't. If you don't, you go through another cycle. This cycle's coming to an end. So certainly, those who've repented will certainly find themselves what? Not subject to another cycle of unrepentance, that is for sure. We call it the end of the church age, the end of that, you know, this mission, during this cycle, the end of that. Now, it seems inconceivable to me that somehow we're going to be able to change the world in such a, or the circumstance such that that all these phases, 1, 2, 3, and 4, will flourish in this world. Because the world's in the grips of the unrepentant. And the authority and power and authority of phase one, for instance, the Western world, the Christian church, the great Christianity, let's say, in its various expressions, which absolutely has always claimed an authority to forgive. And claim that those who take refuge in the church are subject to church law, for sure, and should not be persecuted, or persecuted by secular, unrepentant authority. That the confessional is absolute, sacrosanct. They've insisted on a sacrosanct. They are a citadel of refuge, and it's that which is being attacked and broken down. This sabotage, it has been a contrivance. It's been sabotaged, actually. Intentional contrivance, planned sabotage. And so once that gets broken down, it's really, there's nothing to take refuge in. Phase one, you have to feel like you're taking refuge from the harshness of this bureaucratic monster, from Big Mother. You're taking refuge from Big Mother. Absolutely. And pagan ideology always goes to worshiping Big Mother, that which is supposedly intuitively in tune with nature. And we always see that as Mother, having this mother-child experiencing, okay. And so, of course, phase one, this effort, taking refuge from Big Mother. You do not want Big Mother to be running the religions, do you? Absolutely not. There's no refuge there then. There's no refuge there whatsoever. Keep in mind that there are plenty of ex-actresses who desperately want to take refuge from Big Mother too. They don't want Big Mother in the church, running the church either. No way. In fact, they're probably even more adamant. In my opinion, the church, really, Christianity was probably founded more by women than men. And they were adamant that no women running this institution, forget it. Because having been pagan priestesses in the past themselves, they want no part of that, return to that. No part of that, so they insist. If you object, go ahead and wear a dress or something. if you want women in the church, well, why don't you just wear like a frock, like wear a dress, essentially. But that's as far as you're going to go. So I really believe it was the women of the early church who absolutely insisted that there be no women running this refuge from Big Mother. Stay out of the bureaucracy of it. Stay out of the bureaucracy. Having long association with this Big Mother bureaucracy, knowing just how the horrible state of lostness that you arrive at there, and they want to be saved. So they said, "Hey guys, you know, you got to step up to the plate here. You can't be worshiping Big Mother here. This is not what it's about. So you got to stand up and, you know, stand up for truth here." And so they supported the men. They insisted upon it. And that's the only way that the church got started. There's no way that men can start any such thing like this in this world, in the pagan world. It's impossible. It's impossible. There has to be insistent women at the root of it. Which is why when women give up this role, then the world collapses back into paganism. If they give up insisting on this, if their heads are turned, say, "Hey, wait a minute, maybe going back and being a priestess is actually going to be a lot of fun again," you know, and they get reseduced into it. Maybe being part of this new world bureaucracy is finally going to be fulfilling for me. They get seduced back into it, and when they no longer insist that men stand up and do their role, the men collapse out of it. They cannot sustain it. They cannot. And this is the problem with the modern day institution, especially Christianity around the world, though, is now basically saying that we want Big Mother to be running these institutions, that Big Mother can do a better job running this refuge from Big Mother. That's putting confusion in charge of curing confusion, absurdity in charge of curing absurdity. That's putting the fox in charge of the hen house. Okay. This is a complete disaster. Anyone who's truly enlightened, if they have to have a nature body, as a female nature body, and they're truly enlightened, they will look and say, "Hey, you know, a refuge from Big Mother, from the belief in nature, you cannot have women running that." They will be very supportive. They say, no, we'll be," and again, you cannot have the bureaucracy being run by women. You cannot. But the women are the ones who are supporting the men running the bureaucracy. Without that support, the whole thing will collapse. In other words, mothers need to support the sons, saying, "Hey, you need to go into the priesthood. You need to go into this. This is very important." Nowadays, they say, no. "You need to hang out with pagan women. They're the ones that have the answer. They'll clue you in how to get in touch with Mother Nature, how to be in harmony with Mother Nature." So you have mothers raising their children, emphasizing that ultimately collapses the whole phase one situation. And then without phase one, there's no phase two, three, or four, or five. So what you have is an apostate world. You have an apostate world. We're living in an apostate world right now. Question is, do we want to? Is this our chosen dwelling place? This our, you know, do we really want this to be our dwelling place? An apostate world? Jesus told us that the church age would not last forever. There would be an end to the cycle when the world would become an apostate world. And that's when he said he'd come back, take us to another place that he's prepared for us. That's at least what the Bible says. No confirmation in phase two or phase three from Jesus on this whatsoever. And so far, no confirmation in phase four. They're still being mum about it. You know, no yes or no. They didn't say nothing. I received no yes, and I received no. Neither one. So it's not been ruled out at all. Not in the slightest bit has it been ruled out. Which to me would indicate that maybe it's in play. At least potentially, right? I mean, you could build a case for that, that it's in play. If it's not been ruled out, why would they not rule it out? Difficult to say. I believe that it's possible that they're not telling us because it would interfere with our focus on phase 1, 2, 3, and 4. It would distract us, which is true. I believe that is true. If you're all you're thinking about is rapture. I know there are many Christians who all they're thinking about is when is the rapture? When is the rapture? When is the rapture? Instead of grinding out this ordeal of full stop in the now, full stop in hearing, full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. Clarify. This is what has to be done. Those who do that, whenever, if something occurs, whenever it occurs, they just relax into it and say, it's no problem. I don't have any continuity fear. So maybe that's why, you know, I've not gotten any specifics. Because it might very well short circuit, you know, this intense preparation. We're certainly preparing for enlightenment, for sure. And that enlightenment certainly has options. Enlightenment has options. No question about it. So, pagans want to be completely in charge of the bureaucracy of this planet, completely in charge of all laws, completely running the whole thing. Basically what they're saying to religions is either you let us do this or we're going to crush you. Either you put pagans in charge of the whole bureaucracy of your refuge or we're going to crush you. And then they also insist that there can't be any refuge anywhere that they're not running. And that eventually they say, well, eventually we'll crush your refuge too and run that too. And that's what they're saying about Jesus. Jesus, you can't have any dwelling place that we're not running because we don't want that. And if Jesus says, well, I do, they say, well, maybe you do for a little while, but as soon as we get enough power here, we're coming after you, see? So it's not, you know, it won't be a refuge for long. This is their attitude. So it's a very intimidating attitude the pagans have. It's basically saying, we'll develop such a severe confusion that we'll be able to confuse you too, Jesus. We'll be able to confuse you too, Longchenpa. Well, guess what? They're wrong about that. You cannot confuse Jesus, you cannot confuse Longchenpa. They're free of confusion, absolutely free of confusion. They know that nothing has ever been created, so to speak, as Longchenpa said. There's never been anything happen. There's never been any crystallization. They're absolutely clear about that. There's no confusion whatsoever. So they absolutely can manifest sanctuaries that are inviolate fortresses to confusion. Absolutely they can. So all this posturing of the pagans, it's just pagan posturing. It's just pagans posturing, just like the news. What is the news? The news is about idiots being idiots. Okay? That's all the news is, idiots being idiots. Is that news? Are we supposed to pay attention to that and say, oh, this is big news, an idiot acted like an idiot. My God, we got to pay attention to this. And that makes us smart somehow? That we're investigating, well, how is it that an idiot acted like an idiot? How amazing. This is all the news is. Some knucklehead acted like a knucklehead. And actually, more to the point, two knuckleheads together contrived to act like knuckleheads together. Is what it really is. So why watch the news? There's no reason to not watch the news. Idiots will act like idiots. Knuckleheads will act like knuckleheads. It is what it is. There's no news value, no news either whatsoever. So the pagan revival is very real. The pagan revival is worse than we know. The pagans on this planet have actually been trained, subtly trained, by pagans from other places in the cosmos, which is why they seem to have suddenly taken on such confidence and skill, you know, in being unrepentant, in being delusional. They're very crafty. They're very skillful and crafty at what they're doing. Very confident. They're getting this confidence from other pagans that are from other places in the cosmos who are actually influencing the pagan revival on this planet. Whose goal is to put pagans in charge of all refuges from paganism, from nature worship. They want to take over all such institutions and run them, bureaucratically run them, and in most cases run them into the ground. You know, like a big corporation will want to take over another corporation and say, oh, we want to have this marriage between these two, and so they buy up this corporation, they get on the board of directors, they take it over. But people are saying, their real goal is to destroy this company so they won't have competition for their original company. And what they do is they eventually split the company up, they run it into the ground, and it's no longer any threat to their corporation. So this is exactly what's happening here. They want to take over these institutions, these refuges from paganism. They want the fox in charge of the hen house. What's going to happen to the hens? Right? The fox says, oh, don't worry, no problem, I know how to run this just right. Later you look up and all the hens are gone. What happened? Oh, they're all gone. See? Unrepentant pagans should not be worshipped, should not be welcome in refuges for the repentant. No way. No way. Or that should be very carefully dealt with, you see. There should absolutely be standards that the pagans cannot stand, so they don't, you know, they just say, oh, I gotta stay away from that. I don't like this place. I don't like this place. I don't like church. Get it. As pagans, certainly they don't. And so they're saying, no, we want to go to church. We just want the experience to be something we like. So in other words, we want to be in charge. We like the building. We like the structure of the building, nice architecture. And we like the ceremonies and the ritual and the pomp and circumstance. And we kind of like the singing and we like this and this. So, you know, we just get rid of this other stuff and change the liturgy around here and all that stuff. And so, yeah, we want to kind of maybe go to church for a little while. And then, of course, they lose interest in it later on. Then it becomes house, and then eventually it houses the priestess oracles, you know, goes back to that Roman times, you know, and pre-Christianity Roman times also, and where the great idols were set up, you know, in these marvelous building structures. So we're just giving it an opportunity for this burn, you know, to mellow out. That's all. We just keep talking. The burn is mellowing out here. We went through an intense burn. Intense medicine. Spiritual chemotherapy, really. This is spiritual chemotherapy. It's needed. It's needed. Don't think the pagans have some remedy for their own paganity, for their own confusion. Doesn't have a remedy for confusion. Does not. Pride does not have a remedy for pride. Absurdity does not have a remedy for absurdity. Whim does not have the remedy for whim. To believe so is insanity. It's ineffectualness. And since we have no choice but to be effective, it's a waste of time. Something that should not be honored. Should not be respected. Wasting time should not be respected. Should be admonished and condemned and admonished. Not passing ultimate judgment at all on anyone, you see. But certainly not a member of responsible society at all. So most of the people on this planet are no way members of responsible society. And these are the ones running the show here. And again, they're very skillful. Pagans are very skillful in rationalization, because those who live with this severe continuity fear, unrepentant, have to be very skillful in rationalization. So they're very skillful in rationalization, but it's all absurdity. It's nothing but absurdity. Therefore, you cannot engage with that cleverness. You simply say you must repent and go through the phases. Go through repentance. Take your medicine. You must take your medicine. We're not discussing about taking your medicine. We're saying you must take your medicine. So start taking it. Either you take it or you don't. If you've repented, you're going to take it. If you haven't repented, you won't take your medicine. There isn't anything to discuss. There's nothing to discuss with the pagan, actually. And we're finding this out. You know, nothing to discuss whatsoever. And of course, they're addicted to that discussion. So if there's a mass exodus of the wise from this planet, you know, who are the pagans going to discuss with? They'll get tired of discussing with themselves. They like to tear into, they're like termites. You know, there's no more wood for them to munch on. And what are they going to do, you see? They'll start getting... So I start feeling freaking out. No more, you know, religions to bash. What are they going to do? Yeah, probably become wine connoisseurs for a little while, which many of them are doing. And how long is that going to satisfy them? You know, spend all their time subtly bashing wines. That wine, no, this one. This one and this, comparing it, just endless. You know, how long is that going to intrigue them, really? So we continue phase four. Continue to be without information about an exodus. But continue to have that on a slow burn, on the back burner, all right? That's a slow burn. These practices here are the hard burn, you know, it's really, really intense, intense burn. Full stop in this intense burn. The slow burn is, what is going to be the situation as we move forward, ultimately here? I don't want to be part of any pagan world, flat out. Do not want to be part of, I don't care how winsome the face is that beckons me into a pagan world. No, I don't want any part of it. Ever. Again. So, there's really no point in paying any more attention to the marketing. You know, they trot out as many winsome faces and forms as they can for it. Okay, but there's no more interest in that nonsense. Their marketing is garbage. Worse than garbage, confusion. So this is just, I don't want any part of any pagan world. This is a world administered by pagans, pagan world. I'm not going to be a foil for them. I don't want to be a foil. I don't want to be the noble adversary. That's a very thankless job, to say the least. So I have no interest in a pagan world. I'd rather go to a world where there's the institutions that the phases, the five phases, are set up. The four phases leading to the fifth. And where those who are born into have an appearance as a nature body in those worlds are come there for the purpose of repentance. Either to get into the second, third, or fourth phase, or to start the first phase. Which means that they're starting the first phase, they are ex-pagans. They come from a pagan background, but they're pagans who have decided, you know, we're going to repent. So, you know, I see the best solution, just brainstorming here. Go to another dwelling place, make sure the institutions are set up very well there. So when the pagans from this planet and other planets who have been through this hell of pagan worlds and bureaucracy, big motherism, decide, hey, I want to repent, but I can't do it here. I mean, they go through a transition of dropping the nature body, and then they reacquire a nature body on this other dwelling place where it's possible, the institutions are there, and then they're able to get started on phase one. They're able to get started. Now, phase one, it may take several lifetimes. That's possible. Very possible. Most that I see in phase one are not going to phase two. Most. So they may spend a series of lifetimes in phase one. Eventually they start moving into phase two. Once you move into phase two, then phase three can happen very quickly. Will happen, and phase four. It's possible to go through phase two, three, and four in the same lifetime, actually. That's what I've done. Phase two, phase three, and I've been phase four in the same lifetime. If you dedicate your life to it, absolutely is possible. Of course, these are oracle priestesses of the mother bureaucracy, big mother bureaucracy, mother nature bureaucracy, want to make their oracle sites as attractive as possible. So, of course, they want to have these oracle sites as beautiful as possible, with the most beautiful music possible, and the most beautiful clothes, and the most beautiful landscaping and flower. Everything, they want it to be a place where people go, and the jaw drops. Like, oh my gosh, look how beautiful, how in harmony this place is with nature. They want it to be an expression of harmony with nature. Now keep in mind that I was, in a previous life, a master of harmony, counterpoint, musical harmony. And the priestesses, the matriarchy, Mother Nature, bureaucracy, matriarchy, they saw that as super, super, super important for them to set up, to establish their oracle sites, okay, to set up this priestesses, pagan priestesses, oracles, because as beautiful as landscaping is, as beautiful as the location is, as beautiful as the clothing and the structures, the buildings, everything so beautiful, it still feels flat. Because it is, okay, it is done. And so you add music to that. You add music piped in everywhere in music. And then people get this sort of ethereal, dreamy feeling like, oh, wow. You know, it adds that, it's like gravy on the potatoes, you know, salt on the corn. You know, it's, or the rice. It's that which makes the meal palatable, music. So I was a very valuable commodity to the matriarchy, which is why the matriarchy has relentlessly pursued me. because the talents I have with being able to arrange sublime harmony are very, very, very high talents. And they want those talents, you see. So they promise me, you know, whatever, everything can promise, just promise, promise. Just, basically, they're just lustful. They must have this. You know, they're greedy. They say, without this, you know, we might have to turn and look in a mirror and face our continuity fear, you know. But if they keep getting all these people worshiping them, they think, oh, you know, I'm doing a great job acting. I don't need to look within at all. So I've been under this, you know, tug of war, you know, this terrible. Not only that the hell of it is they fight among themselves. Okay, they fight among themselves. Each oracle wants the best music at their place. And so if you're really talented at producing this celestial, harmonious music, arranging it, knowing how to put on a program, everything, to make the whole ambience feel celestial, you know, they fight among each other. They say, no, I want to be the best actress. And so there's intrigues between these priestesses, severe intrigues. They want their place to be the best place. And if you're really good, then you think you'll be, everything's nice for you? No. You know, there's all sorts of plots, including if they can't lure you away from another priestess, they'll kill you, assassinate you, so that other priestess oracle doesn't have that music anymore, and so that they seem then, you know, greater. That's absolutely what happens. So you may think you live in splendor and greatness. You live in fear for your life, full of intrigues, feeling like you're very unstable ground, actually. The envy. Envy is extreme in paganism. Envy, lust, greed, competition, grandiosity, pride. Each priestess wants to be the best. And so if someone else has the best composers and that she can't get them, get rid of them so the other one doesn't shine so brightly, you see. So it's an entropic system. This whole pagan entity is an entropic system. It collapses into chaos and war and envy. And just, it's horrible. It's brutal. Of course, they always claim, well, we're going to avoid that this time. Well, of course they want to avoid it. But there's no dynamics whatsoever that bring about the avoidance. Same old thing. You know, vanity is very brittle. The vanity of worshiping Mother Nature is very brittle. Trying to get your happiness from confusion, from delusion, is very brittle. Very thin ice, very thin ice. Of course, I was under pressure from this psychic realm of priestesses, priestess, oracle priestess, who insisted that her mission or her oracle site was going to be unquestionably the best. And in fact, all these concerns I had about intrigue and assassination and all this hell, you know, she said, no, don't worry about that, because my site is going to be so beautiful, so great, so wonderful, that everyone else will just say, oh, this is obviously the best, and there's no point, you know. So she gave me the spiel about how great it's going to be. Very convincing, except that leaves out the fact that the other priestess sites will be extremely envious of this. And she said, no more envy. They'll all agree that I'm the greatest. really? Is that how it actually works? So I had to look into this and know that it's a lie. Big time deception. They may act that way for a while, but all the while, since they're unfulfilled within, worshiping nature never works, they feel they need to be the greatest. So they may play the role of the understudy, the humble, meek understudy, but they want to triumph over all. And that doesn't disappear, even if you have the most wonderful structure, most wonderful site, oracle site in the world. You know, the envy doesn't go away. The competition does not go away. So I was definitely lied to an extreme of someone who truly felt that they were capable, with the right support, to be the ultimate goddess oracle. There's no such thing. The Holy Spirit's the ultimate oracle. The Holy Spirit is within everyone. It has no sight, so to speak. It's right here, right now, everywhere. Now, the dwelling place that Jesus could have made for us, manifest for us, may be incredibly beautiful. And the goddess priestesses may insist that, well, if we just go there and figure out, okay, this is what beauty looks like, and then come back to this world and then build up their little, you know, their oracle sites to be like incredibly exquisite. They may, you know, insist upon that. We said, no, that's not how it's going to work. Which is part of why we may go into a vision of oneness, a vision of this just exquisite oneness. And it's really these goddess oracles who are calling us back, saying, okay, now you had an idea of the oneness, now work on my vast estate here, my oracle center, to make it seem like the oneness, to give the impression of the oneness here. So everyone will want to come to me, and they'll say, oh, I feel like so much oneness here, you know. It's all contrivance. It's all contrivance. It's all decorating, exterior and interior decorating. It's all coloring, different colors, how to match everything. It's all the landscaping. It's all the feng shui. It's all the feng shui, something like that, of the whole situation. It's how to, you know, it's the totality of all the ambience that is, but it's all contrived. It's all an army of experts trying to give the impression of this, you know, this oneness dwells here more than somewhere else. This is where you can find oneness. This is the center of oneness. This is where you're going to get oneness. And then, you know, people get deceived by that. And of course, the goddess actress oracle is extremely severe. You know, sees one thing out of place. Hey, that doesn't look like oneness to me. You know, vicious. Of course, her face to the world is all pleasant and pleasing, and then, but really vicious. Like, hey, you know, that leaf right there, I don't think this color is quite right. I think you need to change the whole color. Oh, wait a minute, this grove of trees, it's not in the right place. Move this grove of trees over there. The stones there, I don't like those stones. They get wet. No, you see there's some mold on the stone. These stones have to be pristinely clean. You know? Or you got to give the appearance of age to all this stuff. Make sure it's age just right, but don't let anything grow on it's not right. The demands, the insecurity of the goddess, oracle, actress, is endless insecurity, because the oneness isn't there. She doesn't feel any oneness. She knows she's a fraud. She knows she's a fraud. And so the insecurity permeates the upper levels of management there. Permeates. You know. Doesn't reach the lower levels of just laborers so much. They're just told, this is what you gotta do, do it fast, do it right, and they say, okay, I'll labor. So people look at the labor, say, look at the happy laborers. Well, that's nice. They're this place. They come here because they love the place. They like working on a place. But if you start going in the upper levels of management, those are close to this hell on wheels actress, goddess, oracle, you know, they're like, you know, on medications, stressed out, freaked out. You know, we gotta make today perfect. We gotta pull this off. We got to make this goddess seem like she is the one that's somehow personified. You know, we got to pull off this illusion constantly. And they just, you know, are fried. Insecure. It's hell. It's absolute hell. Serving the goddess is absolute hell. Absolute hell for upper management. Total stress. Total stress. So, going to the place that Jesus has prepared, we're not coming back to give tips to the upper management who are presenting this actress. We're saying, repent. Hey, upper management, repent. Repent. You don't need to do this. And it's often those who have been in upper management of serving the goddess or actress oracles who are desperate for repentance. And those are often the ones that defect to repentance. And these goddess actress oracles know that. These pagan goddesses know that. That's why they hate religion. Because they know that religion, they're going to lose some their top staff to Jesus, to religion, to Buddha, to whomever, right? They're going to lose their top staff. Just as they have lost me, you see. And so, of course, they feel that these are interlopers on their turf. They're interlopers on their turf. They don't want them. They don't want it here. They don't want to lose their top staff. They don't want defections. They feel like it's a cancer. It feels like a rot. One defects, and they tell the other, say, hey, I'm in this other situation, and I feel acceptance, I feel peace, I feel like it's repentance, the best thing I've ever done. I feel I'm on a spiritual path. I feel I'm never going to go back to this hellish situation. You guys should check it out, too. You should check it out, too. And then, you know, the defections start. The goddess, oracle actress, loses her power. The estates don't look so beautiful. The illusion start, the spell, that the illusion cast begin, people begin to say, hey, wait a minute. You see how that, so pagan entity begins to collapse. When you have the presence of refuge from pagan entity, it begins to collapse, inherently so, which is why they want to take over all these refuges from pagan madness. They want to administer them too. You see, they don't want, obviously, they don't want their collapse, the collapse of all their top staff. This is the madness, the insecurity of pagan world, totally insecure. It's hell. You may think the top staff have all these perks. They live in hell. Really live in hell. Live in total fear of this actress, her viciousness, her rage. You know, these goddess oracle actresses have intense insecurity, intense rage, intense fury. Kind of fury that like will just about kill you if they direct it towards you. Just like petrify you. They're so ferocious in their fear. They're basically saying, if you don't produce this illusion, you're gonna annihilate all of us. You're gonna annihilate me. You're trying to kill me. You know, you're trying to. They're responding to this continuity fear. They don't understand what it is. They say, I feel this fear of absolute chaos, and you guys have not organized it properly. Look, and so they're so afraid of inner chaos, denying, you know, salvation from it, believing they're trying to create a separate reality, which is based on this illusion of chaos. That they will see chaos, they will feel reverberations of it everywhere. So they'll look out on something that's perfect. You did it just right, and they'll say, you know what, it's not, you didn't do it right. And they say, well, I did exactly as you told me. He said, no, it's not right. It's not right. I feel something wrong with it. I feel something wrong with it. Control freaks. Okay. He says, no, I don't care if you did what I told you. It's not right. It's not right. Change it. Fix it. Fix it. Fix it. This is a projection of their fear of chaos being projected out into the world and then demanding that everybody fix this. Well, their projection continues. So no matter what you do, it's not good enough. It's never good enough for the goddess. It is never good enough for the goddess, actress, oracle. Never good enough. You're always fixing it. Something. Fix it. Fix this. Fix this. Fix this. Fix this. How come you're not doing what I want? How come you don't intuitively know what I want? How come you're not in tune with what I want? How come you can't do what I want? How come you can't fix it the way I want? Because they're projecting fear of chaos onto the world, and they want, the order's never enough. The harmony's never enough. What they're seeing is never good enough to take this inner dread away from them. So it's you know, to go back to this hideously failed situation of pagan society, matriarchal bureaucracy, big mother nature worship, priestess, oracle, actresses. To go back to that is the stupidest thing possible. It just shows that we're still in the grip of it. The continuity fear, unacknowledged continuity fear, projects chaos, imaginary chaos upon the world, feeling we need to get in touch with nature about what we need to do to fix this, to get rid of this feeling. Return to Big Mother, Oracle Priestesses, we're right back in the same old madness as before. Surely Jesus has to know this. Surely Longchamp has to know this. So, because this is what is happening here. And so surely I'm aware of this. Surely I have no desire to get back into this. That business. And just cannot, I cannot function in that business anymore. I just lose all, it's become total inertia. I just can't function that way. And of course they know it. So they say, we don't want anything to do with you. You can't help us. So I'm not helpful in a pagan society at all, really. Like, I'm not helpful in a pagan society that's controlled by, no. I don't have any helpfulness quotient left for that. I've seen through it too much. So they gotta know I'm pestering them. I'll keep pestering them. So let's find out, come on. I shouldn't say come on. I'm saying, look, I'm gonna keep pestering you until you feel it's I'm ready to get some information, right? So, all right, we've gone through an intensive here. We've gone through an ordeal. And unquestionably for me, I'm clearer than ever before. I'm more comfortable in this exalted context of the fourth phase here. It's exalted context, but we're getting comfortable. We have to get comfortable in this exalted context. It is exalted because we're in touch with fifth stage, adepts, no continuity fear. Fifth phase, so to speak, who've relaxed into the oneness totally. We are in touch with them. We are getting advice from them. We are seeing how the pagan big mother nature, priestess, actress, oracles, all of that stuff, pagan world, is totally unacceptable for us. We have no interest in it. We're seeing through it, through and through and through, of what it's really about. Now, this is exalted a territory. And what do you do in exalted territory? You get used to it. You get comfortable with it. That's all you can do. You just get comfortable with it. You just keep working at it. You keep working at it until you just feel, yeah, I'm totally used to that information. Yeah, I'm very comfortable with that information. I'm very comfortable with where I am. Absolutely. Fifth phase adepts come and talk with me. Yeah. Sure, of course. I'm absolutely comfortable with that. Absolutely comfortable with accepting transmissions, clarifications, ultimately taking refuge. Absolutely comfortable with it. So we're going in that direction. Every minute you spend in this is a minute very well spent, because consider the alternative. Okay, do you really want to go back into high management of this impossible high maintenance priestesses who are projecting their fear of chaos and expecting you to fix it for them? Is that what you want your destiny to be? Because that's what it's going to be. Or actually, since you don't want that, you're going to have no role to play whatsoever here. You see? No role to play whatsoever. Keep that in mind too. So, we better spend our time this way. That's how I feel. I mean, I'm pressured to such an incredible extent right now. Have to spend my time this way. All right. May the absolute blessings of God's grace flow in an unrestricted way to everyone, and overflow, be an overflowing abundance of this grace present with everyone in all apparent situations, all apparent crystallizations whatsoever, knowing the brink that brings to light the freedom from delusion that there are any such creative crystallizations whatsoever. Okay. So with that, we will end this video.